Ali Muhammad. Dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm going to have to apologize in advance to everybody on the right-hand side of the hall. Today's program is actually an election special where we've got some of the candidates who will be running for the Hall Green Member of Parliament role. And so we'd like to open the hall up to the ladies. There's lots of space here on this side. Can I please humbly ask everybody on the right-hand side of the hall to come onto this side, and we will make a special dua and prayer for all of you. And while doing that, if I could ask some ladies to start beginning to filter through, and inshallah, we will begin the program. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Thank you, and apologies for that. If I can ask the ladies in the meantime, the right-hand side of the men's hall is now vacated. You're welcome to come through if you wish. In the meantime, if I can just ask the PowerPoint to be loaded, please. As the ladies are coming through, I'd like to run through a brief itinerary for the day. Are there any more ladies we're expecting? Okay. And inshallah, we'll begin. We'll just give the ladies just a few more seconds. If there are any more ladies, inshallah, we'll begin. We'll just give you a few more seconds. Excellent. Thank you. I think we'll just, I'll begin by just outlining the itinerary for today's program. It's a relatively brief one. Inshallah, we'll begin the program after a very brief introduction by myself, with our resident alim, our Minister of Religion, Sheikh Nuru, to say a few words to set the scene around the elections and the importance of political engagement, after which we will have an opportunity to hear from some of the candidates who will be running. We're delighted to welcome them here today, and we really look forward to hearing from them. As you know, our congregation, our mosque, is in the Hall Green constituency. If we jump onto the next slide, so the elections are next week, Thursday, the 12th of December. So this particular slide just says the different wards that are fall under the Hall Green constituency. And I believe many of our members here today and those listening online will probably be living in many of these areas. So Borsal Heath, Bilsley, Brandwood, Kings Heath, Hall Green, Moseley, Sparkbrook, Spark Hill, Tisley, and Hay Mills. So it covers a fairly large chunk of south-east Birmingham, and hopefully it's something that's very important to all of you. The next slide, so Hall Green is a particularly interesting area whereby previously, if we just jump on the next, so at the upcoming elections, we will be having people from six different parties running, so Labour, the Greens, the Brexit Party, Independent, Liberal Democrats, and the Conservatives. And if you jump onto the next slide just for a second, the next slide actually shows the result from the last election, which, as you can see, there was a strong Labour majority with 77% of the people, of the votes, going to Roger Godsiff in the Labour Party. Now, this election, as we'll come to know, is slightly different because we'll have Roger speaking very shortly, but he'll be running for the as an independent candidate. And hopefully we'll hear more about that very soon. But it's just something to keep at the back of your mind as we listen to the candidates, listen to Sheikh, and inshallah take it from there. So without further ado, please invite Sheikh with a salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. In the name of Almighty Allah, most gracious, ever merciful. We begin by thanking Almighty Allah for giving us this opportunity to have this discussion and dialogue on the most important matter to all of us in the United Kingdom in these days and nights. And that is the election which is upon us. I want to take this opportunity, my respected brothers and sisters, and our dear fathers and mothers, to shed some light on the importance of taking part in this very crucial, if not one of the most important elections in the history of democracy in this country. It is important that we all exercise our constitutional rights. And the topmost agenda on our constitutional rights is to go out there and vote. Not all of us are here, but I'm sure some of our members are online watching, and this information will also be disseminated to those who are not here and not with us online. It is moral, religious, and spiritual duty to go out there and vote. That is your power as a citizen, as a legal resident in this country. That is your voice. It affects you whether you like it or not, whether you vote or not. Some will come and tell me, no, it doesn't affect me. I said, no, it affects you. Directly so. I'm not even going to say indirectly so. How does it affect us? Number one, those people that we are going to put in power, you've got that power with you. You've got the power of voting, and each and every individual has one vote. There is no one who will go there and be allowed to vote twice. It is illegal. It is totally against the constitution. Even the prime minister has only one vote, and each vote matters. Each vote counts. Your vote can make big difference. How? You see, this constitutional right that we have will affect our life, whether positive or negative. Number one, we all use NHS. Whoever is going to be your leader tomorrow, I'm not going to stand here and tell you who to vote for. I don't have that right, and I'm not allowed to do so. But whoever you're going to vote for, it will affect you. We all benefit from NHS, and we will love to benefit and continue benefiting from it. So that is number one thing we need to be mindful of, and it is really important that we think about it. Number two is about Brexit. There was a referendum. Majority voted for the United Kingdom to leave European Union. All the candidates have shed light on what is it that they're going to do after this election. Your vote matters. You listen to them, you watch them. Whatever way you're going to vote, it will affect. And lastly, why is it important? It's important because after the election, you can't reverse it back. Once you put them there, They're going to the House of Commons. They're going to decide. They'll not come back to you again. That is why it's crucial to make your mind based on issues. We as Muslims and as lovers and followers of Ahlul Bayt, we cannot fold our arms and say, that day I'm going to chill, I'm not going to vote. You'll be doing disservice to yourself, to your family, to your community, and to the country. And most importantly, you'll be doing disservice to your children if you do not go out and vote. So therefore, my mission is very clear. I am standing before you to encourage you passionately so, to make sure you go out there on the 12th of December and cast your votes and exercise your constitutional rights. If for whatever reason you do not know how to go about it, in terms of where are you registered, where are you supposed to go and vote, whether in Mosley, Bosol, Heat, whatever. Brother Kazim is here, Sister Sajida is here, I'm also here. We should be able to guide you so that you know where the polling stations are for you to go and cast your votes. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Thank you for those encouraging, motivating words, Sheikh, and for highlighting the importance of the election. Right, so without further ado, as I mentioned, we have some of the candidates here today. Unfortunately, some of them could not be with us. And so the order of play will be, we will hear from our current MP, which is Roger Godsiff, after which we'll be hearing from Izzy Knowles from the Liberal Democrat Party. We'll have a short video from the Conservative candidate, and unfortunately, he sends his apologies, Tahir Ali, the Labour candidate, was not able to make it, and neither was Patrick Cox, the Green candidate. I'm not sure about the Brexit Party. Hope we didn't forget to contact them. But hey, anyhow, so Roger is, we're delighted and very thankful to Roger for being with us today. He's got a very tight schedule and needs to leave. I promised him by 9 he'd be able to go. So if I could ask you to please welcome Roger Godsiff to the podium with a salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
My friends, brothers and sisters, could I first of all very much echo what your Imam has said about the importance of voting in this election. It is your democratic right, and like him, I urge you to vote. My friends, I've been to your mosque on many, many occasions. During 27 years, I've been privileged to be your Member of Parliament. I've worked with your committee on a number of projects that you've had, planning in connection with your extension work you wanted to carry out, and I've dealt with, looking around this room, I can see many of you who come to me at my surgeries. I hold surgeries every week of the month, and I don't cheat people. I'm always available. I always try and help people. I don't take money off people, and every single thing that's said to me remains confidential to me. No casework of any sort has ever been divulged to anybody else. That is the way I work as a Member of Parliament. My friends, I've been a Labour Member of Parliament for 27 years. I was a Labour councillor in London for 20 years before, so I've represented the Labour Party for nearly 50 years. I had a problem that arose in my constituency. And that problem related to one school and how that school was teaching the Equality Act, the 9 protected characteristics. I supported the Equality Act. I voted for it. And I voted for the ministerial and DfE guidance that went with it. But all of a sudden, at that school, there were parents protesting outside. Now, In my experience, parents don't go and protest outside their own child's school. They protest against councillors, and rightly so. They protest against MPs, and rightly so. But usually they cherish the relationship they have with their child's school. So when I saw there were parents protesting outside, I knew there had to be something very wrong. So I listened to what the parents said, and I saw the letters the parents had written. And what those parents were saying was not that we don't want the Equality Act, because they're not daft. The Equality Act actually protects religion, so it benefits them. What they were concerned about was that some highly sensitive issues within the 9 protected characteristics, gender assignment and sexual orientation, were being imparted to very young children at the age of 4 or 5 without any parental involvement, without the parents having a meeting. Schools have meetings all the time with parents, but not on this issue. So there was no collective meeting with parents. Parents weren't shown the materials that the school was going to use. So I went and saw the head teacher. And I said, look, bearing in mind that 99.9% of the children at this school are from Muslim households, and bearing in mind the ministerial guidance, which I voted for, says very clearly that religious sensitivity should be taken into account when engaging with children over these 9 protected characteristics, and that they should be engaged at an age-appropriate age. So say I, bearing in mind what the guidance says, and bearing in mind the demographic makeup of your school, wouldn't it be a good idea if you took these 9 protected characteristics on a rolling basis? Now, amongst those 9 characteristics, there's age and disability. Very young children understand age. They've all got parents who are old. They've got grandparents who are very old. They understand that concept. Many have families, many have members of their family who are disabled, have disabilities. So they understand that. But asking children at the age of 4 or 5 to investigate their own sexuality, to engage with sexual orientation and gender assignment, was challenging for many parents. Not just Muslim parents, many parents in other denominations also had their concerns. So anyway, I offer a way of doing it, which would have ended the protests immediately. And the answer I got, the head teacher got up from the table opposite me, walked round the table, closed the door behind me so her assistant couldn't hear what was being said, came back and said, actually, Roger, I quite agree with many of the things you're saying. But if I was to do what you're saying, the LGBT community would have something to say about it. Now, my friends, the meeting finished very shortly afterwards because I couldn't say anything more. But I did reflect afterwards. What right has any group in our society, any group, to have a veto over how the law of the land is implemented? Now, my friends, because I then said that I thought the parents had justifiable reasons for protesting, a small, intolerant, vicious, spiteful group decided to wage war on me. And they said, Mr. Godsiff, you took the side of the parents, and for that we will politically kill you. Now, that group are only small, but they have massive influence in the Labour Party and trade unions. And they use that pressure to ensure that I was not allowed to be the official candidate. And instead, the Labour Party imposed the candidate, doesn't live in the area. The 1,250 members of the Labour Party had no say over it. They just imposed, the ruling faction imposed their own candidate. And I think they thought I was going to roll over. Well, that's not my way. If I think a cause is just, I'll fight. I've always been prepared to fight on behalf of my constituents. And I wasn't going to roll over. That is why I'm standing in this election as an independent Labour candidate, number 4 on the ballot paper. Now, I haven't left the Labour Party. Labour Party deserted me after service of nearly 50 years. If I'm elected, I will support the Labour Party in Parliament. And I hope it is a Labour government that's elected. But the fact of the matter is, you will have a choice between 2 Labour-supporting candidates next Thursday. And I say, my friends, and Izzy's here from the Liberal Democrats, and I say with great respect, you saw the figures on the screen. Last time, in 2017, I got 42,000 votes. The Conservatives got 8,000. The Liberal Democrats got 3,000. The Greens got 800. So I say with huge respect, particularly to Izzy here, none of the other parties can win in this seat. So it's a choice between 2 Labour-supporting candidates, somebody who has been your MP for 27 years, who's worked with you, who's fought the issues that you brought to me, who's dealt with the cases that individuals have come to me with, who you know, or somebody who has been imposed by the ruling clique in the Labour Party, and they think your votes, those 42,000 votes, belong to the Labour Party. They don't belong to the Labour Party. They don't belong to me. They belong to you. And it's your choice next Thursday as to who you want to vote for. There is not the slightest possibility of another party, and I say again with respect to Izzy, another party winning in this seat. But there are 2 very different Labour-supporting candidates next Thursday. And my friends, it's your choice. Now, before I finish, the gentleman at the back insisted, Mr. Amaraki Sadek insisted, that I should give attention to a note that he gave saying that if I'm elected, will I work with the council to try and get traffic lights outside because of the speed in traffic or speed bumps? Well, I'm more than happy to do that. To be perfectly honest, I can't remember that he raised it with me before. He may have raised it with one of the councillors and such like, I don't know. But he's raised it with me here. And yeah, if I'm elected on 12th of December, I'm more than happy to engage with him and with you and to take up with the council the question of speed bumps outside or, and it's more difficult, traffic lights. But my friends, I end by saying this. I thank you for giving me the opportunity of coming along and talking to you tonight. You know where I stand. It's your choice next Thursday. If you want to help me, if you want me to remain as your Member of Parliament, then you vote for me, number 4 on the ballot paper next Thursday. My friends, I thank you once again.
Thank you very much, Roger, for that very moving speech, I thought, and hopefully that clarifies and explains his view on things. I'd like now to move on to the Liberal Democrat candidate, who is Izzy Knowles. We're really delighted to have her with us today. I think it's the first time you've come to our mosque. Please invite her with a salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. He had 10 minutes, but if you can aim for 5, that would be great.
I'll try. Okay, well, you can tell I'm Liberal Democrats. I've come from a climate emergency meeting and I've been busy all day, so I didn't have time to change. And I just want to thank you all for inviting me here tonight. It's an absolute pleasure to be able to come and talk to you. So yes, my name's Izzy. I moved to Birmingham a long time ago to work in a children's home in the 70s, and I joined West Midlands Police with the best part of my career, 30 years police service, being as a neighbourhood sergeant. And after retirement in 2013, I worked as an outreach worker with homeless and vulnerable people from Digbeth and Balsall Heath, Moseley, King's Heath. I've been described as a community activist, and I get involved because it's what I like to do. And if I see a problem, I want to learn what the issues are and be part of that solution. So I'm an active volunteer in a number of different organisations, including District Housing Liaison Board for Hall Green and the local police independent advisory group. So I can hold the police to account when you have issues with how they're dealing with things. And they know that I know how it all works, so they don't pull the wool over my eyes. I run a group called Moseley Litterbusters, which is a group of volunteers you may have heard of. We help to enhance the sport pride in the neighbourhoods, and we have groups now in Moseley, and also we have a group in Balsall Heath. And if anybody's around on Sunday, 9:30 outside the baths, we will be cleaning the streets of Balsall Heath, and we have got residents coming from Balsall Heath, and we're hoping to set up their own group there. And it's growing all over the place. It's fabulous to see so many people wanting to take an active part in keeping the streets of Birmingham clean. And one of the things we also do is hold the council to account for not doing it. And in fact, I actually had a go at Councillor Malik the other week because of the mess that was down in Edward Road, and it's been cleared up. I also help run Moseley Farmers Market, which has done a lot to boost the economy of the profile of Moseley as a destination. And I set up an alternative giving campaign, and I'm on a board member of another one. That's to help us support homeless and vulnerable, encourage people to give to that rather than give to people who are begging on the street. And then we use the funds to support them. We have an outreach worker who works in both Moseley, King's Heath, and comes to Balsall Heath as well. But even 2 years ago, I didn't expect to be here pitching to become our MP, because I do live in the constituency, not very far from here. I passionately believe that as a country, we're safer and stronger, and we're better off inside the European Union, working hand in hand with our friends and neighbours with the deal that we already have. And the more I've learned about Brexit, the more I'm convinced it's not about in or out anymore. It's about us as a country. And I think we're being failed on so many different fronts. We've got a Prime Minister who is pushing a hard, selfish and uncaring agenda to appease the hardliners his party has attracted. And we have a leader of the opposition who's ambivalent to the damage leaving the EU would do to this country, who failed to stand up to the millions of people who want to remain and who did nothing to call out and challenge the lies of the Leave campaign. And when I've been campaigning in the last 3 years to stay in the EU with a group called EU in Brum, one of the things that really got me motivated to do something about it is one of the first street stalls we did in the middle of Birmingham, and I was talking to a Birmingham guy probably in his 50s, and I asked him, why do you want to leave the EU? And he pointed across and he sort of went like this, and he pointed to this wonderful, diverse, fabulous, multicultural community that we have in Birmingham that I so love and admire. And he said, all of these will be gone. And it filled me full of chill. And that's, I think, one of the reasons we have to fight this. We really do. And also, I think the other problem is racism. And both the main party leaders are systematically failing to deal with racism and prejudice within their ranks. The Labour Party is currently being investigated by the Equality and Human Rights Commission for numerous alleged incidents of anti-Semitism. And the organisation MEND, I'm sure you're aware of, is calling for the Conservative Party to be investigated for alleged incidents of Islamophobia. And as politicians, I think we all have a duty to set an example to others and to consider the effect of our words and our actions, and to consider the effect of the words and actions of our party members as well. So Brexit is what made me political, but it isn't the only reason I've stuck my head up. I've lived and worked and volunteered in this area for most of my life. I've lived in Hall Green, in Moseley, King's Heath, and I've lived at Borsa Heath in the police station at Edward Road in the 80s. So I know Borsa Heath very well. And having lived here, I feel I'm in a good place to understand and tackle the very many issues that matter to people and to take on the injustices that prevent people succeeding in life, such as the housing crisis and mental health and poor education and inequality and prejudice and racism. And my experience of working with communities of all faiths and none is we all want the same things for our families and friends. We want sound healthcare, we want good housing, we want clean air, we want affordable public transport and decent schools and good care provision for the elderly and the right to live in a safe and a welcome neighbourhood. And our strength in the Hall Green community, and by Hall Green I mean all of the areas that were mentioned, and it's our diversity and that's our community spirit, and I absolutely love living here. And the people of Hall Green deserve to be listened to and to be involved in the decisions that affect them. And I think that does not happen, and it has not happened for a long time in this area. Hall Green has not had a committed local representative in Parliament for many years. And I believe it's time for change. And as your MP, I'll be highly visible, I will be hands-on, I'll be local, accountable, and I will be contactable. I will have an office in the area, I will be here, I will be going to community meetings, I will be holding the council to account. And when someone needs help or advice, I'll be there. Because it doesn't matter who they are or what their politics are, everybody matters, and we can always find common ground. And I'm willing to listen and to research and to call on and learn from the many people, both locally and beyond, who are expert, whether it's in business, public services, education, health, or on the ground community activism. And I'd harness that knowledge and guidance and community power to champion Hall Green and our fabulous city, to work as a team to bring investment and improvements and to tackle those inequalities and injustices. And as your MP, I get things done and I would hold people to account. And I very much hope that I will be given that chance to use my enthusiasm, my dedication, and my skills and experience as the first Liberal Democrat MP for Birmingham Hall Green. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that passionate address, Izzy. Now, I'd like to move on to the next candidate, who is the Conservative candidate. Her name is Penny Ann O'Donnell. Unfortunately, she couldn't be here with us today. However, she has sent a brief video message, which it's a very short 3-minute, I think, clip, which inshallah will be played very, very, very shortly.
Penny, could you introduce yourself to the members of the... the Kodra community in Birmingham?
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Penny Ann O'Donnell and I'm standing as a Conservative parliamentary candidate in the upcoming
Penny, could you introduce yourself to the members of the Kodra community in Birmingham?
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Penny Ann O'Donnell and I'm standing as
Penny, could you introduce yourself to the members of the Kodra community in Birmingham?
Assalamu alaikum. Penny Ann O'Donnell, and I'm standing as a Conservative. Parliamentary candidate in the
ready. All right, 3, 2, 1.
Penny, could you introduce yourself to the members of the Georgia community in Birmingham?
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Penny Ann O'Donnell, and I'm standing as Conservative parliamentary candidate in the upcoming general election on December 12th. I want to apologise that I can't be with you in person. I was so looking forward to meeting you. But today's a very special day. It's my wonderful father's 85th birthday, and I mention that for two reasons. 5 years ago, he was not in resuscitation, and I fought that, and Daddy's been with us for another 5 years, and then sadly, this wonderful, strong Irishman who came over with nothing in his pocket and nowhere to stay, he sadly broke his neck and became disabled, but he's allowed to walk again. And so tomorrow, we're going to get him out for lunch, and we're having a family with him, and he's going to take his first steps out of the house in a very long time. And I think it's a blessing of a day, and I'm sure you'll understand why I need to be with him on that special day. Thank you.
Thank you. So something I think a lot of members of the community would like to hear about is Islamophobia within the Conservative Party. Is that an issue, and what's your view on it?
I would say it's Islamophobia is not run through the heart of the Conservative Party, but we have to acknowledge there have been episodes of Islamophobia, and last week the Prime Minister actually apologised for those episodes. And any councillors or representatives who've been found guilty of Islamophobia have been suspended and received the diversity training that's been recommended. We feel so strongly about episodes of racism within the Conservative Party that we are having an investigation into all forms of racism within the Conservative Party. That is not what runs through our all-inclusive party. Penny, another issue very much here in the area is homelessness. What's your plan on that? Well, I've been to Portsmouth and I've seen the homelessness, and it's just not acceptable that we have this level of homelessness in today's society. But homelessness is a complex issue. It's a fantastic initiative. Join Dan Dean Street and his campaign, and it's called Housing First. And it's a £9.6 million project, which is getting homeless people permanent accommodation. And 25% of the units already provided in Birmingham have been taken up by homeless people. So we are moving on a journey to get back into everyday society and having a new progress.
Penny, of course, this election is also mainly about Brexit. What's your position on that?
Okay, so I've been very open about the fact that I voted to remain, but on the day of the referendum, I fully respect democracy, and I've been working very hard to support people in getting this done. Now, Boris has got a deal. Maybe he's going to get it, but he's got it. And we just need help in pushing that over the line. And I've heard from the community, people are aspirational small business owners, and we need to make sure that you have certainty with your business. I come from an immigrant background, I'm a first generation born over here, my parents came from Southern Ireland, and they had their small company, and they needed certainty in that company. And we cannot have this impasse down in Westminster anymore. Something has to change, we have to realise the vision of this fantastic country of ours, and we can only do that by getting Brexit done, and Boris and the Conservatives will certainly do that for you.
Penny, what's your final message to the people of Hall Green?
It can be so different for you in Hall Green. When you arrive in Uganda, that drive to succeed, that desire to have a better life, that ambition and that aspiration, that is what has made you such a success today. And those aspirations and those visionary ideas are what is a part of the Conservative Party. You've had years of a Labour MP who's been completely disengaged from you and taken your vote for granted.
I'll just play the last 30 seconds of the clip. I do apologise, and it's not because of my leanings against the Conservative Party that I did that. I can assure you.
When you arrive in Uganda, that drive to succeed, that desire to have a better life, that ambition and that aspiration, that is what has made you such a success today. And those aspirations and those visionary ideas are what is at the heart of the Conservative Party. You've had years of a Labour MP who's been completely disengaged from you and taken your vote for granted. How dare he? Nobody owns your vote. You can vote for whoever you want. I hope if you have the vision for Hall Green that I have, you will lend me your vote on December the 12th.
Apologies for the slight technical difficulty with that, but I hope most of you could hear that. And we thank Ali for helping organize that video. That brings us to the final of the candidates' speeches. I'd now like to hand it over to Sheikh. We thank the candidates once again for their time, and we wish them all the success with whatever the outcome of the result of the election is. We'll now have Sheikh, inshallah, end the program with some masaib and a conclusion. We'll have Ziara, and during chat, if anybody wants to come to the front and chat to Izzy and ask Sheikh any questions, you're more than welcome. It'll just be informal while you drink your chai, inshallah. But thank you all for listening so attentively. Please invite Sheikh with the salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Thank you, Brother Kazim and Sajida and the Secretariat of the Jamaat for organizing this session. And of course, thanks to all the candidates who accepted our invitation to be here tonight and shared with us what they aspire to achieve when given the nod on the 12th of December. So as I said earlier on, brothers and sisters, mu'minin and mu'minat, it is important, and I cannot stress on how important it is for all of us to go out and vote on the 12th of December. It is our right and it is a duty. That is the only way you can ensure your voices are heard. So many things are at stake. You heard the candidates, those who are here and those who are not here. Go home, think about this. Don't just vote for voting sake. Vote based on issues. Try not to be just a spectator. Try to be well-informed voter. So many things on stake. NHS, Brexit, school feeding for those who depend on it. You know, prescription medicine for those who depend on it. You name them. There are so many things at stake. So you need to do due diligence on how you go about it. Encourage your family, wives, husbands, brothers, sisters, sons, and daughters who are of the age of voting to go out there and vote. And the good thing is that there is enough time for voting. So you don't have to go early morning to vote. If you are unable to do so, if I'm not mistaken, it is open up until 10 p.m. So you've got enough time to go there and cast your vote. And make sure when you go there to vote, try as much as you can not to like meet someone you want to lure him to vote for you at that particular area. Make sure you go out there, you vote, and then you disappear, you leave there. Place, inshallah. And as I said earlier on, if you have any question on how to go about it, we have Brother Kazim, we have Sister Sajida, and myself, I'm also here. If you need any help on how to go and vote, the registration is already over. But for those who cannot go on that day, you can still vote by post or by proxy, And I think he's still, oh, no, proxy is over, I think. Yeah, unless you've already got the vote. So if you have not done it yet, then it's over. You have to go there yourself and vote. We wish you all the best of luck. All the candidates, we wish them all the best of luck. And we pray that everything go smoothly across the country. Now, inshallah, we conclude, of course, to our guest. This mosque or this center, I'm sure you know the name of this center. It's Khoja Shia Isna Ashari Muslim Community. So every Shia is Muslim, but not every Muslim is Shia, if you understand what I mean. So, because I want you to understand what I'm going to do now. So it's important I put you in the picture. So we are who we are as Shias because we subscribe more to the families of Prophet Muhammad, you know. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. And one of the sons of the Prophet Muhammad is Hussein. I'm sure you heard of Hussein. Because there is an organization called Who is Hussein. And last year also we had Hussein Summit here. So Hussein stood for justice. Or social justice as we call it today. Against one tyrant who wanted to deprive people of their God-given rights. And to exercise their choice in terms of their faith. So Hussein went out, defended that right, but eventually he got killed. So normally every year as Shias, we meet for 10 nights to remember the values that Hussein stood for when he was championing human rights. So every Thursday, we conclude our programs by remembering how Hussein stood his ground when it comes to defending social justice. So that's what we call in Arabic Masaib. Masaib is plural of Musiba. Musiba means eulogy or tragedy. So we're going to recall some of the sins, and maybe you will see some may be crying, some may not be crying. So that is what we're gonna do. We believe there is blessing in concluding our programs with that, and it reminds us not to forget social justice in our lives. So brothers, Mominin and Mominat, we take our hearts to the Holy Land of Karbala and remember a few lines of the Masaib of Aba Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam, and we will ask God Almighty that the reward of this Masaib go to the souls of the departed ones, our loved ones who left us. Aba Abdullah Hussein, as you know very well, brothers and sisters, when he arrived in the Holy Land of Karbala, he arrived with one mission, and that is to inform the world and those who were present at that time that the tyrant by the name Yazid cannot be allowed to rule. Hussein had 72 companions who stood side by side with Hussein. But the 72 companions, one after the other, lost their lives. And eventually Hussein, alayhi salam, was left alone in the Holy Land of Karbala in the Republic of Iraq. Hussein looked at left, right, son was in there, brother was in there. He even lost his six-month-old baby while in the process of defending human rights. That final moment of the life of Aba Abdullah Hussein, Mu'minin and Mu'minat, as Arbab al-Makatil mentioned, Aba Abdullah rode his horse and he headed towards the water of Euphrates. He was thirsty, and the horse was thirsty. But because he was a champion of human rights, he got down, he went to the water, he got the water. He did not take the water for himself. He went straight to the animal, to the horse, and gave water to the horse.
But the horse refused to take the water from Abu Abdullah. That's the heart of Hussein. Animals even had rights in the encyclopedia of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. He insisted that the horse should take water, but the horse refused to take the water. As Abu Abdullah Hussein was trying for the horse to take the water, the enemies then began their headways towards attacking the tent of Hussein. And in that tent were the sisters of Hussein and the daughters of Hussein. One of the daughters, Sakina, was only 4 years at that time. He then left the water. He did not take even a sip of that water. He then rushed back to the tent. When Abu Abdullah got to the tent, which we call Khaymaga, he began to bid his final farewell. As he was bidding the farewell, he looked around. He could not see the four-year-old daughter. He looked at his sister Zainab. He said, "Zainab, where is my daughter Sakina?" Zainab looked at him. She said, "Ya Abu Abdullah, Sakina has no energy to look at you anymore." He then began to walk towards Sakina. He went, he saw the young daughter. He asked Sakina, "Come, let's bid final farewell. I am going, Sakina. I will not come back." Sakina looked at the father. She said, "Father, when have you known me to sleep at night without being on your lap?" He hugged her. He patted on her shoulder and her head. Then he began to walk. As he was walking, she called him, "Papa, are you going and leave us here? Father, if you are going, then take us back to the holy city of Medina." Abu Abdullah looked at the daughter. He said, "Sakina, alayki bis sabr, be patient, O Sakina." He gave her one last hug and he headed towards the fold. Enemies attacked him and they surrounded him. You know what happened? The first one struck the arrow on the forehead of Abu Abdullah. As he was trying to remove the arrow from the forehead, another arrow came on the chest of Abu Abdullah. As he was trying to remove the arrow from the chest, another arrow came on the shoulder of Abu Abdullah. Narration mentioned, eventually he fell down. And as they said, while he was on the ground, he was like a hedgehog, surrounded by arrows. But you know eventually what happened? One of them had to sit on the chest of Hussein. They did not just kill him, they slaughtered him. They beheaded Hussein. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa say'alamu alladhina zalamu ala Muhammad. Ayyamun kalabin yankalibun. Wa la'akibatul muttakin. Inshallah, before Ziyarah, raise up your hands. Let's make dua, inshallah. Let's pray. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, our mu'mineen and mu'minat, especially our father Kanani, who left this world a few days ago, and of course Hajj Munir and Hajj Mukhtar and all those who left us, may God Almighty forgive them and grant them Jannat al-Firdaus. May Allah tabarak wa ta'ala grant them neighborhood of Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. We those who are still here in this world, may God Almighty forgive us our shortcomings. We ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that all legitimate desires we have, for it to be fulfilled on our behalf, inshallah. And the last prayer is, we pray to Almighty God that on the 12th of December, the entire country will be going to the polls. We pray to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that the election, right from its beginning up until the end, goes smoothly without any issue or problem, inshallah. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi at-tahirin.